his character. Call the meeting to order. I'd like to call on Councillor Fehr to bring the opening, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Lately, I've been making a bit of a mission to go around and speak with people from Steinbach area and just how they view Steinbach. And so this is what I came up with. Steinbach has developed several core values. A core value is something you are, not something you aspire to become. Steinbach is a benevolent city with many people who believe that they've been blessed in order to look after those who are not able to look after everything themselves. We just have to look at the amount of people who live in group homes and have people who take care of their day-to-day needs. Why would they locate here if it wasn't for the excellent care available? We have a good home care system and also private organizations that look after people who need just a bit of help along the way. Many churches and various other organizations here add so much value to the city by instilling good values and helping people whose lives, for whatever reason, has not turned out as they had hoped while they were growing up. These organizations and churches minister outside of their walls to help the less fortunate make a difference for those that are less fortunate in our community. They provide social help, practical help, and spiritual help. Thanks to organizations such as Today House, Soups On, Helping Hands, Lions Club, Rotary, Four Winds, Agape House, I could go on and on. We could all name more than that. The lives of our residents are much better. We also have the Bethesda Foundation, who do an amazing job in ensuring that we get appropriate funding for healthcare services for the residents of Steinbach in the area. They advocate for the city and add tremendous value. I've spoken with young people who say that when it is time for them to have children and raise a family, this is the place where they want to raise them. These people have lived in many other communities and cities across Canada, and yet they choose to live and raise their families here. Many older folks that have moved here for jobs have made a decision to stay after they retired from their professions because they love the city. Try walking down the street of Steinbach and see how many smiles you see. Maybe people nodding their head or a warm greeting. This is something you don't see in every city. People, for the most part, are very friendly here. I think this also has to do with how we present ourselves. If we present ourselves as friendly and welcoming people, we'll find more people act that way towards us. Are we perfect? Absolutely not. We're human, but I think the heart of most people here is towards being kind, hospitable, and warm towards others. That's why we are known to be one of the most benevolent communities in this country. But let's not for a minute think that we have arrived. We must always look for ways of being a friendlier and more welcoming city every day. That way we will continue to be known for what we have come to be known for many years already.
Thank you, Councillor Fehr. We have the agenda in front of us. I'll just add to 12A, and that is a motion from Councillor Slagstra. Please put that on the agenda. Can I have a motion to approve the agenda, please? Moved by Councillor Penner, second by Councillor Funk. Any discussion? Call for the question. All those in favour? Carried. We have the minutes of July 5th, regular council meeting on page 1. You've all had a chance to review those. Can I have a motion to approve, please? Councillor Penner, second by Councillor Swagstra. Any discussion? Anything further from council? Call for the question. All those in favour? Carried. No business arising from the minutes. We do have a number of public hearings. We'll start shortly. But before we do that, we'll move to the 8A, and that is the reports and recommendations from the city manager. This is on page 90. Mr. Workentine, the Canada 150 Mosaic.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. This file is returning to council for some additional consideration. It was first brought to council's attention sometime in late 2015. With respect to a community mural project that the federal government is sponsoring for communities throughout Canada, known as the Canada 150 Mosaic Project. Staff have been working on some further background and additional information as part of that program, and most recently opened up the initiative to community input with respect to what the community felt were key icons or images or particular items that were noteworthy that they felt would be appropriate to represent Steinbach's mural, as was previously approved by council earlier this year. There is a report that provides some background. In addition to the report and some of the documentation on pages 93 through 98, you will see photocopies of some of the submissions that were received, both from the public, either directly to city administration, or through some anonymous drop boxes that were put up at both the Steinbach Soccer Park and Mennonite Heritage Village during the recent Canada Day celebrations. Many of those submissions are pretty rough around the edges, but they do represent at least an indication of what many in the community thought were important icons. However, based on the overall count and other submissions that the city has received, it has been suggested that the windmill be chosen as the overriding icon to represent the Steinbach's mural. As it appears to be the residents' first choice that they best feel represents Steinbach. And there are some next steps as far as how the process is recommended to proceed on page 92. However, I am requesting council's consideration for the decision to officially adopt the windmill as the primary icon with additional tiles to be painted to be formed as part of the mural so that administration can proceed.
Thank you, Council. How would you like to proceed? Councillor Swagstra.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'll make the motion that we approve the windmill as the design.
Okay, is there a seconder? Councillor Penner, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think it's I think the windmill is an obvious choice for an icon that represents the city. It is a long-standing symbol of our city. A windmill was constructed shortly after the first Mennonite settlers arrived in this community, and the windmill is one of the first things you see as you're driving in from the north part of the city there. And so it's been a long-standing image of the city, and I think it's appropriate that we incorporate it.
Thank you. Further discussion?
Nothing further.
Anything further from council? Councillor Fehr.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I find it kind of interesting that I feel kind of honored that there's several submissions here that included trucks in here. So I thought just wanted to mention that.
Just to be clear, there's also one that has the lack of blinkers
yeah.
or signal lights. People had fun with that, and that's good. Anything in closing? All right. Council, we have a recommendation here from administration. I think it makes sense. The windmill has been iconic for many years. It symbolizes where we've been, and it symbolizes, obviously, work and our history. I think it's appropriate to move forward with this. Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. We'll now move to the public hearings. There's a number of them, so we'll go through one by one. I'm going to close the council meeting, open the public hearing for Variation V-2016-04. This is in regards to 17 Madison Place. This is on page 3 for council. Mr. Workentine, I'll ask you to introduce this, please.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. Again, this is file V-2016-04. Owners of the property are Henry Vandeveld and Penny Cabernel. The applicant for the variance is Lowen Henderson Bandman Legault. Purpose of the variance is to allow an east side yard of 3.2 feet, whereas 4 feet are required in the RLD residential low density zone. The house is already constructed and was discovered that an error occurred at time of construction. The notices were issued pursuant to the Planning Act. There is no correspondence received for this file. As indicated by the solicitors for the applicant, it is recognized that the rear yard shed, while it is not on the variance application, is on skids and apparently can be moved to comply with the setbacks. Recommendation for the file is that, subject to any new information that may be provided, that council approve the variance subject to the rear yard shed being moved to comply with setbacks.
Thank you. Is the applicant here today, or a representative? Seeing none. Is there anyone here wishing to object to this file or have any questions? Is there anyone here wishing to object or have any questions? Anyone here wishing to object or have any questions? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing, open the council meeting. Council, how would you like to proceed? Councillor Fehr?
I move to approve it.
Move to approve the recommendation.
Yeah,
thank you.
That's the word, yeah.
Is there a seconder? Councillor Funk. Go ahead, Councillor Fehr.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, this is merely, this house has been standing there for a long time already, and it's just to bring it into alignment with our, so that it complies with the regulations. So it'll have little impact to the neighbors, and so I think it's, it'll make the people sleep a little easier.
All right, anything further?
Nothing.
Anything further from council? All right, call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. We'll now move to 6B, the variation V-2016-05. This is in regards to 180 Main Street on page 14. I'll close the council meeting, open the public hearing. Mr. Workentine, I'll ask you to introduce this, please.
This is file V-2016-05 for property with civic address of 180 Main Street. Owner of the property is Bed Frame Properties, Inc., and the applicant for the variance is Electra Sign, Ltd. Purpose of the variance is twofold. Firstly, to allow a freestanding sign to have a maximum height of 30 feet, whereas the maximum height in the C2 commercial community zone is 20 feet. Secondly, to allow an overall sign size of 120 square feet, whereas the maximum size of sign allowed for this property is 115 square feet. Notices were issued pursuant to the Planning Act. There is no correspondence on file for the application. With respect to the application, recommendation is that the variance for the accessory sign height and size be approved, subject to the sign and footprint being wholly contained on the subject property.
Thank you. Is the applicant here or someone representing the applicant here?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Before I ask, is there anyone here wishing to object or have any questions? Okay. I'll ask the applicant to first take the podium, please. Please state your name, your address, and who you represent.
My name is John Karasevich. My address is 117 Tyrion Place in Lorette, Manitoba. I represent ElectraSign here on behalf of the Dufresne Group.
Thank you. Go ahead. You can make your presentation.
You know, subsequent to the recommendations of the city, we were simply here to present the point that the bylaw would limit the current tenant in respect to the visibility on Main Street. There are currently several pylons that do exceed the 20-foot maximum, including the pylon in question. The Dufresne Group has a fairly established logo, which will work best on a canvas of 6x20, which is the size we've recommended. The height will give it good visibility coming in from Highway 52 on the other side of Highway 12. And it will make it prominent in the same way that other businesses in the area are.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions for the applicant? Go ahead.
Through you, Mr. Mayor.
Mm-hmm.
Can you speak to the issue of the pool that's there now and it's encroaching on city property? And the part of the variance request here is that it be removed. Can you speak to that?
I know that currently the pole is right on the property line and the physical cabinet on the top is encroaching onto the sidewalk. In our application, we had hoped that we could maintain a slight encroachment as illustrated in the attachment. If the city's recommendation and the approval is that it has to be wholly contained on the property, I believe that we, you know, that isn't an unreasonable request, provided that the size remains the same, the visibility should remain prominent on Main Street, which is the whole purpose of the application.
Thank you. Councillor Fehr, you had a question?
I have a question of administration, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, then we'll wait. We'll wait for that. Okay. Just a minute. Any other questions for the applicant at this time? Thank you. You may be called back up. Calling for either objections or questions. You know the routine.
I do. My name is Jean Clausen. I live in the Arm of Hanover, and my husband and I own the building right beside this building. So I'm here more to get information. I didn't know exactly where the sign was. If you all remember, there was a brick wall that covered all those buildings along there. The front was all owned by one person, put a brick wall along there. It's only recently that we've separated them. The sign, when I look up, the sign at the top almost hangs over onto our roof, and our new renovation went higher than the old one. So I'm here just to find out, you know, what exactly is going on. And I heard that it's encroaching on city property. So I'd like to know from east to west, or whatever we call it in this town, if it's really on their property, is part of it. When I look up, definitely it's on our property, or we're on their property, I'm not sure. I may be opening a can of worms here that I'll be sorry for. But I'd like to get a really good understanding of, and also the sign that's existing, how big is it? Like, if they're asking to go bigger, I'd kind of like a, you know, a rough idea of what's there now, so I can sort of anticipate or visualize how big it's going to be.
Thank you. I'll get you to respond to the questions. So please direct everything towards the chair.
Certainly. I cannot speak to the east-west property line, as that issue hadn't been raised prior to the question. So I honestly, I don't know the answer to it. In terms of the size of the current sign, it is 61 inches by 120 and a half inches. So that is roughly 1 foot shorter and 10 feet narrower than what we are seeking. As I'd mentioned, the current design is very square in nature, with the logo that they're looking to put on is a more horizontal style of logo.
So one of the questions is it going to be solely contained on the property itself, or will it be encroaching on any other property?
Based on the info that I have, I do not believe that it will be encroaching on the property in question. Our application was to encroach on the city property. We would arguably still enjoy that if it's available. If the council decides otherwise, I believe that we could contain it entirely on the property.
Thank you. Ms. Clausen, does that answer any
of
your...
It doesn't. If you look at the sign up there, it's like right in line or even a little bit over. So it has to encroach. I mean, we're in air space there. But I don't... Like, I really think it has to be encroaching onto our property.
Are you suggesting you want it encroaching on your property, or are you suggesting you don't want it encroaching?
I'm not sure at this point. We got the letter a week ago, and, you know, I just needed information. And I'd like to know. Maybe it's not. Maybe...
So, again, we can't speak to what's there now. Right. We can only speak to what they're applying for, and they aren't applying to encroach over... they're certainly requesting to encroach on city property, but not on anyone else's. So I can't speak to
when
they replace it, you know, if it's going to be moved or whether it needs to be moved or not. But
don't you think we should ascertain where it is before we approve something?
Well, they will be required to do that. If this is approved, then they will be required to locate it on their own property.
Okay.
Completely. And so if that means not in the present location, that's the reality. If it means the present location, then that's the reality as well. But I can't answer that right. No one can answer that right now until they would survey that or figure that out specifically.
Okay.
Okay. Is that clear?
That's clear.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to object or have any questions? Does the applicant wish to say anything in closing? No. Okay. All right. Any questions for the applicant or anyone else? Seeing none, I will. Councillor Fehr, do you want me to close?
I have a question at administration.
Can it be done after we close the public hearing? Okay. Thank you. Then I'll close the public hearing, open the council meeting. Councillor Fehr, you have a question for administration?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I just have a question. Is there an administration? Is there any specific reason why we should not allow the 2.5? It's been in existence for some time, and obviously it would be their preference, and I know that they're open to it, but I know what it's like. You always want to get as good exposure as you can. So I was just curious to see whether there's a specific reason why we could request that it be contained on their property.
Mr. Workenday.
Yes, the provision that I refer to is in the city's zoning bylaw, section 42.1, which refers to non-conforming signs. Essentially, there is a policy within the city zoning bylaw that I'll just read the particular section. A non-conforming sign may be structurally altered, reconstructed, or replaced in the same location and position, provided that such structural alteration, reconstruction, or replacement does not result in, and there's a list of items, but the one applicable, an increase in the sign surface area. As the proposal is to increase the sign surface area, recommendation is that the encroachment not be permitted to continue. It is an existing non-conforming situation, with the application that has been submitted, recommendation to follow policy within the city zoning bylaw is being recommended, and that the encroachment be removed because the applicant intends to replace the entire structure.
Thank you. Councillor Fehr, does that answer your question?
I think it does.
Okay, thank you. Question or? Thank you. Go ahead.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. I'm just wondering, the height difference is quite significant. I'm just wondering, is this going to set a precedent now where we're going to get a steady stream of businesses wanting a variance for height? That, you know, maybe the bylaw itself, the height needs to be changed, or what makes this situation maybe unique that it should be the exception?
Perhaps I would leave that up to the applicant to explain what makes it unique. However, I can state that there is an existing sign a short ways down Main Street at another retail establishment, I believe Steinbach Dodge. That sign, I'm not sure of the height, but it is a significant height. That I could state as is there as a precedent. Same zoning.
All right. Any further questions before we ask for a recommendation or where we're heading? Any further questions? Councillor Fehr?
I have one further question of the administration, if I may. That 2.5, is that being encroached upon in any other properties, business properties on Main Street currently that you're aware of?
There are probably a few locations in Steinbach, but I'm not certain as of particular locations at this time. But the encroachment pertains only to the sign cabinet, to my understanding, not the post.
All right. Council, how would you like to proceed? Councilor Penner.
Move to approve the freestanding sign having a maximum height of 30 feet and to allow an overall sign size of 120 square feet.
Thank you.
Providing it is not on the city right-of-way and wholly contained on the property.
Thank you. Is there a seconder? Councilor Siemens, go ahead.
Yes. In looking at this request, I think it's safe to say that this sign will not be a detriment to the area and will, in fact, enhance the business and the chance for success there in advertising. It also falls within what has been there down the street. So there's other examples of larger signs in the area, and I don't think that there's any reason why we should deny this.
Further, Councilor Seaman. Anything further from Council? Seeing none, anything in closing?
Nothing.
No. Call for the question. All those in favor of the variation? Carried. Thank you. We have 6C, variation V-2016-06. This is on page 25. This is in regards to 490 Ash Avenue. We'll close the council meeting, open the public hearing. Mr. Workentine, I'll ask you to introduce this, please. Page 25.
Yes, variance file V-2016-06. Owners and applicants for the application are Raymond and Carmelin Coop. Purpose of the variance application is to allow a 750 square foot shed to be built on the southwest corner of the subject property, whereas the maximum size permitted for an accessory building is 500 square feet in the RSF residential single family zone. Applicant is planning on building a garage slash workshop on the subject property. Notices pursuant to the Planning Act have been issued. There is no written correspondence on file. Recommendation is that the variance be approved subject to any new information that may be provided at the public hearing and subject to an acceptable lot grading plan being provided.
Thank you. Is the applicant here today? Thank you. Is there anyone here with any questions or concerns? Anyone here with questions or any concerns? Does the applicant wish to speak?
Sure.
Please state your name and your address, and you don't have to say, you can keep it as short as you like, or you can go up to 5 minutes.
Well, those of you that know me will know I'll keep it short. I'm Ray Coop, and my wife Carm, and I own the property at 490. Given the conversation earlier, we perhaps should have considered building a windmill. It would have been easier to get an approval, but I don't know that would serve my purposes very well. We purchased the house a year and a half ago. I've parked my car inside twice, and I have a garage full of tools, woodworking tools, and hobbies of antique cars and whatnot. And so we would like to have a place to, I'd like to have a place where I can do that work, where it's neat, kept out of sight from the street. And we looked for long and hard for a house where we could build onto the garage in the back. And unfortunately, once we got into the fine details of doing our due diligence, and there wasn't quite enough room for an additional garage door, roof lines were a nightmare, etc. And so we thought it would just be simpler, easier, and more efficient to build a building in the back. And just so that you know, I have taken the initiative. I approached the neighbors directly to the west of me, which is probably the most impacted, as well as to the east. I've also approached all three neighbors along the back of our property and the two neighbors that are directly in front of our property, and received no concerns from any of them. So that's
very good. Are there any questions for the applicant? Yes, there are questions. I'll ask you to, Mr. Coop, I'll ask you to come back to the podium. Councillor Siemens, go ahead.
For you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Coop, it's good that you have these hobbies. The whole garage workshop thing hasn't been a favorite. We've had a few issues with people working in workshops, creating fires, creating hazardous areas. What are you all planning to do in that, as far as welding?
Well, I'm a little bit interested in a lot of different things, and so I currently weld in my garage, and I currently have woodworking tools in my garage. I make sure that I have proper separation. I make sure that I have fire extinguishers located appropriately. So I'm not going to sit here and say that I'm not planning to do some of those things, because that's what I enjoy doing. But I think that they can be done safely and appropriately with a little bit of forethought and a little bit of responsibility. I've had a workshop like this in a previous residence in a different community and didn't have any didn't burn the place down or anything close to it. So.
Thank you. Any further questions for the applicant? Councillor Funk, you have a question for the applicant. Go ahead.
To you, Mr. Mayor. I too have many hobbies, and my garage is also too small. So this might be mean in the next few years. But I have one concern. I don't have a lot of concerns about building in the backyard, but have you, or what have you done, or what are you going to be doing to ensure, because when we do things and we change our backyards, we can sometimes change the way water flows and drainage, and the last thing I'd like to see is your neighbors now have a water problem because of the garage. What's your commitment to making sure that that doesn't happen?
Well, certainly that is a concern of ours as well. The building that we're building is bigger than the shed. This property had a huge shed, and so that water just all ran off the shed. And we now collect that water for rainwater for our garden and for flowers. And it's our intention that we will continue to do that off the larger building as well. But clearly, we don't quite know what the water will do once the building is there. We're putting a driveway beside our property that's neighboring John's property. And Mr. Elias's property. And so we've had conversations about that. Clearly, if there's a need for something to be changed in terms of drainage, whether that's putting in a drain tile or rerouting the eaves troughs or something like that. At this point, we both kind of don't think that that's going to be an issue, just given the lay of the land, so to speak. But clearly, if there is a concern with that, then that's something that we would address, and we've both committed to each other that we would work towards a solution.
Thank you. Any further questions? Seeing none, is there anyone else wishing to object or have any questions on this?
I don't have any questions.
Okay.
But I have a comment. My name is Jonathan Elias. I live at 480 Ash, Steinbach. Ray's neighbor, you've had questions about drainage. I've had questions. We don't know what it's going to do. We've talked about it. He's not a bad guy. You had comment about aesthetics and the yard building things. He's going to move his shed. His shed looks really cool right now, and I really like looking at it. I don't have control over what his property is going to look like, but it doesn't look bad. If I have to look at a fence, if I have to look at another building, it doesn't make any difference to me. It's not in my yard. I don't have control over it. Honestly, I think it would be an improvement to the neighborhood to have something done in the backyard. And as far as water goes, I think it would be wise to do something with water drainage in that corner as it is anyway. It can only get better from what we've got. So I have absolutely no objections with anything.
Very good. Thank you. Anyone else wishing to object or have any questions? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing, open the council meeting. Council, how would you like to proceed? Councillor Siemens?
Motion to approve the accessory building of 750 square feet.
Okay, thank you, including the recommendation from administration that involves a drainage plan?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Fehr seconds that. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I appreciate the comments by the neighbors, also by Mr. Coopin, the fact that he has talked to his neighbors, he's made those agreements. I think that's critical. Anytime you want to affect your neighborhood, this will affect the neighborhood somewhat because it is 250 square feet bigger than what's allowed. But I think in this case, I think it would, we heard from the neighbor that it's going to improve the neighborhood. So I think that we should allow it to go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Fehr, anything further? Anything further from council? Anything in closing? No. Council, we've heard from the applicant. The applicant obviously needs to be commended. He's gone to see his neighbors, and that's what we want. When things are changing and things are evolving in a neighborhood, you go talk to your people around you, and you make sure they're good with it, or you make adjustments accordingly. So Mr. Coop needs to be commended for that. So with this, we do have an application for a larger shed than our larger building than normal, but the work has been done. Clearly, it'll improve drainage because of the plan that will be put in place, and we look forward to seeing this come to fruition. I do say, though, that I hope Mr. Coop's handiwork is better than his handiwork with the whiteout on this one page. But that's fine. That's not what you're here for.
I don't know which page you're looking at, sir.
Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. Thank you. All right. We'll go to 6D. This is the bylaw 2067. This is rezoning on Stonebridge Crossing on page 36. I will close the council meeting and open the public hearing. Mr. Worgentine, I'll ask you to introduce this, please.
Mr. Mayor and members of council, this is bylaw number 2067, application for rezoning for property. Doesn't have a civic address. It's currently a vacant piece of property located on Stonebridge Crossing. Owner and applicant for the application is Bridge Park Village, Inc. And purpose of the zoning bylaw application is to rezone the property, the subject property, from RLD, residential low density zone, that is shown on the sketch in the notice provided in your package, to RMD, residential medium density zone. Notices pursuant to the Planning Act have been issued. There are currently two pieces of correspondence on file that were included in Council's packages for information. Recommendation is that City Council give second reading to the bylaw subject to any new evidence being presented at the public hearing, and it's subject to prior execution of a development agreement.
Okay, thank you. We do have the applicant here today. Does the applicant wish to speak?
Mr. Mayor, City Councillors, thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Lee Kiebert. I represent Bridge Park. We are a not-for-profit community organization, and our mission is to support and enhance independent, healthy living for seniors. Presently, we have completed three phases on our campus. This includes Bridge Park Village. I did bring some pictures. Maybe we could show some, so you get a little better idea. So this is Bridge Park Village. This was our first project. Then we have included in our packages the Bridge Park Manor Phase 1, and that'll be a different picture. There you go. Phase 1 is on the left, and Phase 2 is on the right. Those are basically three buildings that presently make up our campus. In addition, 15 to 20 years ago, Bridge Park purchased residential land adjacent to these properties, and we purchased it for future opportunities. In addition to this land, the City of Steinbach gifted Bridge Park the land that was supposed to be the extension of Henry Street. Bridge Park then amalgamated the two parcels of land, and now it forms 1.6 acres in total. The 1.6 acres is zoned residential use, and Bridge Park is asking the City of Steinbach to rezone this land to medium density multi-dwelling housing for future development.
Thank you. All right, are there any questions for the applicant at this time before I ask for objections or questions? Mr. Fehr, you have a question for Mr. Hebert?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, if I may. Just, do you have any ideas to how long into the future we're talking here? Is this like 1 year, 5 years, 20?
We don't have any immediate plans. We don't have any specific plans. We just want to get it ready so that it is available for that opportunity when it comes.
Other questions for Mr. Hebert? Councillor Penner.
Yes, I note that there are some properties along Albert Street which back onto that parcel. And do you have any idea of what kind of buffering you could provide for those residential properties on that street?
Right. We haven't discussed that at all because we don't have a plan right now. Obviously, we want to be sensitive to our neighbors. Of the eight properties that are there, I did make contact with five and explain what our intent was. But no specifics have been laid out.
Any other questions for Mr. Hebert? Okay. For now, thank you. Is there anyone here wishing to object or have any questions? Okay. You've seen the routine, your name and address.
My name's Daryl Weeb. I live at 125 Albert. I'm one of the properties that backs directly onto that property. I basically came here today to get more info about what would be built back there in the future. How tall are we talking? How big is that property compared to the other properties that they have? I know some of the pictures that we saw, it's three stories placed on a lot. You know, there's not residential housing immediately next to those properties. So for me, it's not so much that I'm strictly opposed to anything being built back there. It's just what? There are issues with, there was a Henry Street extension back there, which was given up, I guess. I will speak to the traffic that is on Albert Street, and it is actually quite significant. I mean, some days I find it hard to back up off my own driveway because of the volume. I'll speak to the drainage for that property. There's a small ditch that runs through the center, and just about every spring, that property floods. You know, maybe due to the clinic being so much higher than everything else, it just plugs up, and there are sometimes thousands of gallons of water that sit back there until drains can be opened up, and usually floods about half my backyard. With no specifics, I don't know. My questions are limited, right? What can I ask without some sort of a plan? And again, like, I'm not sitting here saying I understand that, that the property is there and things will be built as the city grows. But, I mean, are we talking a one-story, like, one-story, two-story, three stories? You know, how close to my backyard? I'll also note that the property gets slightly smaller towards the back end. It's not consistently the same size, so that also comes in the whole planning thing. I just had a bunch of questions, and I believe they did try contacting us before, but spoke to my common law partner, and I didn't get very much information from that, but it doesn't sound like I would have, because there hasn't been much presented here. But you can elaborate slightly, then that would be fantastic.
Thank you, Mr. Weeb. Councillor Swagster, you have a question for administration. Okay,
yes,
go ahead.
It's like two questions. The first question is that often when we do rezonings, we make it conditional on something, commonly, you know, in terms of number of heights. Is it possible, I'm not saying this would be in the motion, but is it possible to have a condition that it would be used for seniors housing? Or is that, I know we've never had a condition like that, but I guess my concern is that the question before is simply the rezoning. So in theory, even though I think this is very unlikely, in theory at some point in the future, if let's say it doesn't work for seniors housing, you know, you sell it and then it can just be a regular apartment and then the dynamics change. So is it possible to put that type of condition on it, or is that just not workable with a rezoning?
That is a question that I don't believe I have the knowledge to answer clearly and concisely at this time. It does appear that it would be a condition that goes beyond multifamily land use, just because it is so specific, and I'm not sure that a zoning bylaw would have that jurisdiction to put that condition on it.
Thank you. Second question?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is obviously on a similar topic. The question I have is that normally when we have these types of applications, normally there's a plan that's presented. I know that there are times where that hasn't happened. Is this significantly outside the norm? Because I'm just going totally by memory here. How often do we have an application for rezoning to a higher density of land and there's no plan at all? Because most of the time there's a plan and then we're talking with neighbors and we're sometimes talking about height and buffering, and right now it's very open-ended. And so my question is this significantly outside the norm in terms of what we normally deal with?
Based on historical rezoning applications, yes. It has happened before, but it is rare. It is a challenge to explain, particulars of the proposed development when there isn't a lot of information to provide. So normally it is the case with the applicants that they do have a concept plan that is presented at time of the public hearing.
Best question to the applicants.
Yes, one more.
Okay. Yeah. This is to the applicant.
Hebert.
What's the reason for making the application at this time as opposed to in the future when there is an actual plan? Is there a timing issue or?
Well, how should I answer this? Well, I'd like to answer a few questions here, if I could.
Sure, go ahead.
I'd like to start with Mr. Weeb. The mid-density is three levels. It's not. It's we're not asking for anything beyond three levels, and that's what those units are now. In regards, usually, we've been getting grants from the government. We make proposals, and if you don't have your land and your ducks in order, it's pretty hard to get anything, you know, moving. And so we want to prepare for that kind of situation that we're ready. And it might not happen in the next 10 years, but when it does, it happens quickly. And we didn't ever expect to build phase two within 5 years, and we're less than 5 years in the ground with phase one, like Bridge Park Manor, and we're already pretty much completed phase two. There's a huge demand for elderly housing in Steinbach, as you know, and we think that that area, we already have a campus, it fits, I don't know what else that land could be used for right now, and so we just think it makes sense to prepare it for multi-dwelling, and that's why we're here.
Thank you. Further questions? Mr. Warkentin, I think there were some questions that Mr. Weeb had specifically in regards to residential medium density, and so because there isn't a firm plan that's being presented, because they're not in that stage, when it comes to the maximum allowed in a space like this, what is the maximum height and what is the maximum dwelling units that could be on this property?
The provisions within the city zoning bylaw indicates that RMD, the residential medium density district, which is the subject of the application, is intended for either single family, two family, or low rise multifamily residential units and their associated or compatible uses. Typically, the maximum, or I should say, the maximum height for RMD zoned properties is three stories, which from a footage perspective, depending on the height of the story, could be anywhere up to 35 feet. As far as setbacks, there is setbacks that are permitted within those particular zones: front yard of 25 feet, rear yard of 25 feet, and side yards of 4 feet, which is the same setbacks throughout the city.
Okay, thank you. And in regards to drainage plans, there is a talk about just drainage that is occurring there presently, and obviously if there's a new plan that is presented and gone through the permitting process, what requirement is there of a drainage plan?
All new developments such as this one would require a detailed review by city administration with respect to site servicing and other conditions, which includes lot drainage and any required landscaping or buffering. It would also include provisions such as parking, just to ensure that the proposed size of any RMD facility would also have sufficient parking to be available on site.
Thank you. Further question?
Yeah, Councilor Spike. Question to administration. I know that in our package there's the information about the infill housing program that basically has some stipulation. Could the city manager just outline just what are some of the stipulations that would be in place to protect neighborhoods in regards to infill multifamily units? If you could sort of summarize, what are some of the key things that would happen under this policy, that if we approve this, if this gets second and then eventually third reading, and then eventually when construction happens, what protections are in place for the neighborhood? The city manager could just sort of summarize that for the benefit of everyone here.
Yes, there is provision with respect to what's considered infill development, of which because this is this particular parcel is within a neighborhood of the city that is already developed. This development would also be subject to an administrative review with respect to further development. Essentially, it's to ensure that whatever proposed plan is presented, that it generally fits associated land uses for properties in the area, and that it's considered to be compatible. The general objective of the infill policy is that it understands that there could be a mix of low, medium, and high density land uses in every neighborhood. The policy seeks to ensure maximizing the use of infrastructure and ensuring that it contributes to a vibrant, walkable community and enhances the potential for people and families of a variety of ages and income levels to live in the same neighborhood.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just quoting specifically from the specific standards, it says the height of any multifamily developments directly adjacent to a single family dwelling shall be limited so that the height of the multifamily building is generally compatible with adjacent buildings. As part of this review process, height is one of the things that would be looked at, and if in the review process it was determined that a different height was needed, that is a possibility, or because again, normally these types of things are put in at the time of the application. And if we're going to limit it, we do it then. But does this policy have the teeth to be able to impact that if upon the review it determines that this would have a significant impact on the neighborhood?
That is one of the specific standards that is reviewed among others. That's exactly the intent of the infill policy, is to ensure that any future development is compatible. It does make it more challenging because there hasn't been a concept plan provided. However, in the absence of that, the infill policy would provide the guiding policy documentation that administration would use for that.
Thank you. Councillor Penner, please.
Administration, through you.
Yep.
my understanding, if my memory serves me correctly, is that when phase two was built of this development, that it's adjacent to single-level condos on the other side. Is that correct?
I'm sorry, could you...
Phase two that they're currently building is adjacent to single-story housing. Is that correct?
That particular development, yes. It is directly adjacent to single-level condominium-style development.
Is there any difference between that scenario and this scenario?
Zoning is similar and the particular uses are similar, but in that case you are correct. There is a three-story structure that is adjacent to single-story structures.
The difference is, though, that one was RMD and both of them were RMD at the time, whereas now you're looking at RMD and RLD next to each other. So there's that variance, but the usage is the same. Further questions? Councillor Fehr, to
Mr. Mayor. There's one thing that I have a little bit discomfort with, and I have talked.
Sorry, is this a question for administration? Or?
I'd like to ask administration. Okay. Yes, Mr. Mayor. I've spoken to some of the people that own properties on the other side of Bridge Park, and some of them have expressed a little bit of displeasure with having a big building next door to them. And I think it's particularly troubling when it's a condo because you don't have much of a backyard. So those buildings are pretty close together. Is there some way could we tie something in here to something more than maybe 4 feet? I mean, to have a building that would be 4 feet from the side yard and three stories high. I think I would have a little bit of concern with that too if I was on the property adjacent to that. I love the fact that this property is there. I just would like to see a little bit of a comfort level as to how that could be mitigated a little bit with the neighbors. Is there any way that we can maybe tie that to maybe 15 feet from the property line? Or
I suppose council could impose any condition that it or conditions that it sees or feels is appropriate under the circumstances. However, it has the potential of limiting the opportunities for the applicant, given that there is no concept plan that is currently prepared. It does pose a challenging situation. Just because
thank you. Thank you. Anything further? Any other questions?
I have a question for administration to clarify.
Okay.
Kind of what Councillor Swaichter asked. Now, just in a scenario, just so I understand this fully, if they come forward with a three-story plan and the infill policy kind of, you look at everything and it states it needs two, it should be a two-story plan instead to fit. Does our info policy have the teeth to make that happen? I guess you, maybe you answered that, but I wasn't, I just want absolute clarification for myself.
I can say that the infill policy is administrative in nature. It's not of the same weight as, for example, the city zoning bylaw. However, it is intended to be a document that provides guidance, so that when it comes to issues of particular configurations or servicing components of proposed developments, that it does provide an objective guiding document for administration to assist in the evaluation of development proposals.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions for the administration? Seeing none. Mr. Wiebe, you had a number of questions. Do you have any further questions or any comments?
Possibly. I just feel as though a lot of this is, it's vague, and I don't know, our definitions of a compatible probably differ. You know, I've lived there for 10 years, and kind of what Mr. Fehr said is that I don't feel as though somebody building something 35 feet tall, 4 feet off my backyard, I don't view that as compatible. Without seeing a plan, I'm not a bad guy either. I'm not going to sit here and shake my fist and say I don't want housing for seniors. But without seeing anything and just kind of leaving things open, if we don't have the power to say, hey, we're not okay with this later, that concerns me. I don't know what else, how else to say that.
So just to be clear, Mr. Wiebe, you do officially object then at this time?
Yeah.
There are already two objections, so just so you're clear. The reason I ask that is because then we actually send you official letters and we go through a process if it does pass second reading. So we just want to make sure that we know if you're objecting or not, because it's a legal process.
Yeah, I would like to be informed then and see where it is, right? Because I still have questions.
All right, Mr. Reeb, he doesn't want to say objecting.
Yeah.
We'll mark you down as.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, I understand. All right. Any further questions? Anyone wishing to object? Seeing none, does the applicant wish to say anything in closing?
I guess a few times the question has come up for specifics. The way I understand your system, I could have come here with drawings and presented them and then later changed them. So we were trying to be transparent. We have no plans. And so somebody could come here and present something to you but could change it all as long as they build multi-dwelling, mid-density housing. So we have no objective or no agenda to misrepresent what we want to do. I mean, our intent is just to prepare it so that it's ready to go.
I will then close the public hearing, open the council meeting. Council, how would you like to proceed? Maybe I'll just say just a few words. A question to administration now that we're out of the public hearing. Mr. Workendean, if second reading is given today with a condition, for example, that any buildings more than two stories must have a larger side yard on the west side than 4 feet, is that a possibility?
Yes, council could impose that condition if it so chose.
Okay. Thank you. Council, how would you like to proceed?
So, to administration, or you or whoever can clarify this, if we, let's say that we just gave second reading today, could we impose the condition at third reading when we get more information at that point? Because as I'm a little leery about suddenly putting conditions on and we don't have any plan, because we don't necessarily know what those conditions will actually address without seeing the specific plan. So my question is, can a condition be put on at third reading as opposed to second reading? Or it's approved in principle now that in terms of the rezoning, but we could still, if there's additional information that comes forward, that we could put a condition on at third reading.
Okay. My understanding is, and administration might correct me, is that we can, if it is approved second reading today, it comes back after the municipal board hearing, for example, comes back to us approved. We can give it third reading as it is, or we can make it more strict, if I'm correct, but we can't loosen it. Is that accurate?
My comment was going to be slightly different.
Okay, you can correct me. I don't mind.
I was going to suggest if there was a significant change being proposed between second and third reading, that it would prompt a further public hearing. However, I would prefer to investigate further before advising council down that path.
Councillor Fehr.
Mr. Mayor, is it possible to delay this until we see a plan so that we can make a little bit more intelligent, informed decision than we are right now?
We are in charge. We can do what we what we see fit. But you heard Mr. Hebert say it clearly. Councillor Fehr, you heard Mr. Hebert say it clearly, though, that what they're trying to do is prepare this so that they can move to the application process for other things eventually in the future. Councillor Spikstrom.
Aye. I'll make a motion for second reading.
Okay. Motion to approve second reading. Councillor Penner moves that, or seconds that. Thank you.
Aye. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is a challenging one because we normally don't get applications before us that where we don't have a plan. It happens occasionally when there's sort of a long-term plan that, something will happen to this property. Normally, it's not in a location like this. There are a number of things that make this a unique situation, one of which is that the applicant, it's pretty clear what their intent is, that in the future they would like to build additional seniors housing. We know that we need more seniors housing. There is a certain strong logic in that seniors housing would go by other seniors housing, and that be done by the same group that's doing the other seniors housing. That makes sense. I can understand the rationale for wanting to have the land rezoned and ready to go, because if in the future the government does come forward with funding opportunities, it would delay it if you then have to go to the zoning, because if you have even one objection, that can delay the process by months, and then that window of opportunity can be gone. So I understand that rationale. I think the factor which helps significantly is that we do have that infill policy. It is not as good as having a plan before council right now, and then we put the conditions on right ahead of us, but it does have significant weight, especially in a situation like this where we have not seen a plan yet. There's more emphasis that would go on this. And the reason we developed the infill multifamily policy is to have additional protections for neighborhoods, for situations where you're going to have an increase in density nearby single density homes. That way there is that additional review process that goes in place to make sure that the height isn't too much, to make sure that it's reasonably compatible with the existing neighborhood. It is not a perfect policy. Frankly, this isn't a perfect situation that we're in right now, because it is better to have more information. It is better to have full detailed plans in front of us. But I also understand the situation that Bridge Park is in, because in order to be ready to go, you need to have the land rezoned. So because of the fact that we need more seniors housing, and because we know that there will be a municipal board hearing where there is that additional review already, we still have to give third reading at a point. We still have the opportunity to gather information. And we also have the infill policy that when the time comes in the future, maybe significantly in the future, although frankly we hope it's not too far in the future, because we do need the seniors housing, at that time we will make use of this policy, and I have no doubt that Bridge Park will actively participate as part of that to try to make sure the concerns of neighbors are accommodated. The fact that they had already reached out to a number of the neighbors and provided this information is a good step. Bridge Park is a good neighbor. We know their intentions are good, and so I think the situation is unique enough that despite the having less information than we'd like to have on the detail that's being presented, I think that we can move ahead to second reading.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Penner?
I'm not sure if there's much to add to that. However, I understand the objections and that the situation isn't ideal. However, I think in this situation, it's just one of those, you know, when you plan a city, it's impossible to anticipate all the potential needs and how things need to be designed. And this is just one of those situations where I think the benefit outweighs the potential cost. As Councillor Swagstra mentioned, and also Mr. Hebert mentioned, we continue to have high demand for seniors housing. It only makes sense that it continue on the campus that's been developed. In addition, it's going to be close to the new primary health care center. It really is a good location and fit for the area overall, which is why I will
support. Okay, thank you. Further discussion from council. Councillor Fehr.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. I do have some concerns, and if I lived there, I would have more concerns. I want to put myself in their shoes. I think that there's been a message here in all of this. I hope there's been a message here in that there's going to be some dialogue when this happens, that there will be a certain amount of respect for the neighborhood. And one of the reasons I do want to support this is because I don't know of a better area in the city where we could put housing such as this. There's already a community there. And so I think with a little bit of respect for the neighborhood, I think this could be a very good fit for them. So.
Thank you. Further discussion? Councillor Penner.
Yes, I'll support the motion as well. I do, however, have concerns for the 8 or 9 properties that are on Albert Street that will be very directly impacted by the rezoning. I think, though, that Bridge Park is known for integrity and as being good neighbors, and I think that is also a reason why this should move forward. And I trust that, as well as our infill policy, which has specific standards for instances like that, which will be applied by our administrative team, that Bridge Park will also do their due diligence with this. So I will approve the motion.
Thank you. Anything further from council? Anything in closing?
No.
All right. Council, we have in front of us application to rezone from residential low density to medium density. This is a larger parcel of 1.6 acres. When you look at it and you look at it, see it, that it's close to a park, it's close to a walkway, it's also close to other multifamily, this does tend to make sense. The other aspect that we do have, though, is that we do have the infill housing policy that we put in place a few years back, and that does create some protection for the neighborhood when the plan is presented and the planning department goes through it, trying to make sure that it fits well into the neighborhood. And so I'm comfortable giving it second reading. Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. That gives second reading. We will not give it third reading. This will now go to a process of there will be letters sent out to the objectors, and then it will go through a process from there. So, thank you. If you have any further questions, you can always contact the administration. They'll tell you the details. So, okay. Thank you. All right. We'll move on to 6E. This is the subdivision 4451-2015-766, and also a road opening. This is on page 49. I'll close the council meeting, open the public hearing. Mr. Workentine.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, this is subdivision file 4451-2015-7660 for purposes of the extension of Crescentwood Drive and the creation of Lincoln Avenue and Nicolette Avenue. The owner of the property and the applicant for the subdivision is Goldmark Developments, Inc. Purpose of the subdivision is to allow the creation of 32 RSF residential single-family lots, 3 RLD residential low-density lots, and 2 RMD residential medium-density lots, and the extension and creation of the roads as noted. The applicant is proposing to develop phase 2 of a multi-phase residential development just south of McKenzie Avenue. Notices pursuant to the Planning Act have been issued. There is one piece of email correspondence that was received late today that council members would have received in their mail bins. There has also been an additional piece of correspondence issued by Community Planning Services just in respect to some minor amendments to the subdivision application. It does not change the intent of the material that was provided in the agenda package. It's only there as additional clarification if council requires. Recommendation subject to any information that's provided at the public hearing is for council to approve the proposed subdivision.
Thank you. We do have the applicant here. Is there anyone here wishing to object to this file? Anyone here wishing to object? Seeing none, does the applicant wish to speak?
Okay. Good evening, Mayor and Councilor. My name is David Bannon. I'm here on behalf of Goldmark Developments. Excuse me. This is phase two of the Lexington Village development. Phase one hasn't quite started yet, but will hopefully be starting in the next 2 to 3 weeks. Our pre-sales have been fairly good on the first side of the development, so we are looking to develop a variety of lots, as you can see, from medium density to low density to single family density. The first phase was just low density, I believe, was not single, no single family. Most of them will be duplex units. As you come in off of Mackenzie, in the situation, we did felt that we needed a bunch of single family residences as well. And that's why you see phase two. It's probably phase two of, I think, believe there are 8 phases total. So you'll probably be seeing my face a few more times over the next 5 or 6 years. I think that's really about it. If anybody has any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Are there any questions for the applicant? Seeing none, thank you very much. Anyone wishing to further object or have any questions? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing, open the council meeting. We do have a resolution on page 49. It is both in regards to the subdivision as well as the road openings. Council, how would you like to proceed? Councillor Penner.
To approve.
Thank you. Second by Councillor Penner. Go ahead.
Well, this is quite straightforward, particularly considering phase one hasn't even developed. There's not too much in terms of having to get neighborhood input or approval. So this is just good pre-planning, and I think it's pretty straightforward.
Thank you. Anything further, Councillor Penner?
Nothing further.
Anything further from council? Seeing none, anything in closing? No. Council, we have a road opening and subdivision that is part of the new part of Steinbach. This is the newest part of Steinbach from the friendly annexation of Hanover. We see this developing nicely. It's good to hear that they've had excellent pre-sales, and it's good to see them moving on phase two already as they're in 2016. I think this is a good thing. So when you look at this plan, there's a mix of residential low, residential medium, and residential single family. Makes sense. It's well balanced. It's a good plan. Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. There are no delegations. We will move to the accounts payable in the back of the book, page 98. Can I have everyone's had a chance to review that. Can I have a motion to approve, please? Councillor Funk, second by Councillor Fehr. Any discussion? Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. We have the building permits on page 98. There's a motion on the bottom of that page. Councillor Siemens moves that approval. Councillor Penner seconds that. Any discussion? Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. We will now move to questions of council. Any questions of council? Mr. Workentine, if I can get you, I have a question for you, and that is, can you just clarify for us and the public, what are we building on our beside City Hall? There's the question.
Well, it's not a Pokemon Go gym. With the recently approved project to complete the expansion and renovations to the east wing of City Hall, we require the temporary relocation of staff in those offices. That will be the home of the engineering and planning department staff. For most of the duration of the project. We expect somewhere towards late summer they'll move in and we'll move back into the City Hall building at time of completion.
Thank you. And that building then?
The building will be moved off by the builder.
Thank you. Okay. All right. No other questions of council? We will now move to correspondence. That is the Jacob Library minutes on page 99. Take that as information. And 12A, we have a motion from Councillor Swagstra.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Earlier this week, the provincial government announced its intent to review the ban on the use of pesticides. And this is something that that our city, as a council, have taken a clear stand on, that we think that that this pesticide ban is unnecessary. There's a reason that we have an organization called Health Canada to regulate pesticides. And the reality is that this should be able to be the choice of municipalities, whether we use it on city property, and the choice of homeowners, whether they use it on their property. And so in the past, we've passed a motion stating that we're opposed to that ban. The ban has an impact on our bottom line. If we were to use the organic products that are recommended, that would increase our cost over $200,000 a year for lawn care from $18,000. We're not going quite that route. We've gone with an increased mowing policy that still is an extra $30,000-$40,000 a year. And the impact, we're seeing more weeds. I mean, there's no question about it. When you're not able to use the best products, you see more weeds. And so I think it's important as a city that we reaffirm our position and pass on this information to the province. So the motion I'll put forward is this, and I'll wait for a seconder. The motion is that the city reaffirm its existing opposition to the ban on pesticide use, and that we submit this information to the province.
Thank you. Is there a seconder? Councillor Funk, go ahead.
So thank you, Mr. Mayor. As I stated, this is a ban that is unnecessary. People should be able to make the choice what they do with their own lawns, and we should be able to make the choice that we do in city property. We want to have the best areas possible. We want to have good quality sports fields. We want to have good quality lawns, and people should be able to make the choice. If you don't want to use those products, don't use them for yourself, but people should be able to make their own choice. And this is consistent with the position we've taken in the past as a city.
Thank you. Councillor Funk, anything further?
I just concerned with the council.
Council, anything further? Seeing none. Council, obviously you do know that this has been an active file in regards to AMM, and so that's something that's been worked on for a number of years. They've been consistent, and the city is also being consistent, and so I think there is only a benefit to voice our concern. Call for the question. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you. That will be submitted to the province. Motion to adjourn. Councillor Penner, Councillor Siemens. All those in favor? Carried. Thank you.